Hi, sixth grade writers. I am here today to teach you some of the basic elements of poetry. I know many of you are starting to read or have already read Locomotion by Jacqueline Woodson. I hope even long after reading that you're still writing poetry and practicing writing poetry. But I have been getting some questions from some of you over your emails. Nice job. And so I'm going to explain using one of the poems in our book, okay? I'm going to explain 12 elements to you today, and hopefully they make a little bit more sense when you're applying them to an actual poem that you have already read. So the way that this is going to be laid out in this video, hopefully it will be shorter than 10 minutes, is I'm going to show you the elements, and then I'm going to show you the application, the elements in the poem. The poem I'll be using today is on page 71. It's called Photographs. So the first four, the speaker, the subject, the audience, and the context, the speaker is obviously, you know, you would be thinking of somebody speaking in a poem, okay? So the speaker is whomever is narrating the poem. If you can identify them, the speaker in a story that we might write would be called the narrator. But in a poem, poems are typically meant to be read out loud. So we say that the speaker is not necessarily always the person who wrote the poem. So the speaker in this case, in the poem that we'll be looking at, doesn't necessarily mean that Jacqueline Woodson is speaking. She's our author, right? The speaker we know is Lonnie throughout the book, Lonnie Motion, right? And so that is something that I want to tell you the difference between is a speaker is not necessarily the author of a book, right? They might be speaking through a character. So the subject is who the poem is about or what the poem is about. It could be an idea, it could be a person, it could be a place. The audience is typically you as you're reading a poem. You would be an audience member in that case. And the context, you have to sometimes think about a poem's context, especially if it's about a time in history or if it's linked to a story like this poem is. This poem is not meant to stand alone in the meaning, right? You'll see some references in this poem to Lonnie's life, right? So you have to know that context, that background, that history of our character. So I'm going to read this to you once through. I won't read it every time, but I'll go back to parts of it. So this is Photographs. There's two of me and Lily. We were little then, dressed up at Easter time, big smiles, me with two front teeth missing and my head shaved Easter clean. Here's Mama and Daddy dancing, Mama's blurry foot lifted up in the air. Look how she's laughing. When I look at the picture, I can hear it. Here's the four of us, everybody's smiling at the camera but me. I'm looking away from it, frowning, like I see something coming that ain't good. Okay, so we see that Jacqueline Woodson, who wrote this for us in this book, she's doing a few things with Lonnie's poem here. We see that the speaker is Lonnie, right? Because we look at the pronouns, right? Me, we, my, and I have them highlighted here. Us, me, I'm. So when we look at a poem, we always want to try to identify the speaker. And we do that by looking at the pronouns, I, me, right? We know that in this case, the speaker is Lonnie, right? Because Lonnie is our protagonist. For the subject, we can identify what he's actually writing about by the title, Photographs, right? So we can imagine that he might be looking through different photographs. We know that his parents aren't actually there because we look at the context of the story. His parents passed away. So we see him looking at these photographs. We know that Lily's not right there with him. She's in a different house, right? And we know that he has lost his parents, and he's in a way lost Lily, his sister, as well. So we know the context of that. He's looking through these photographs, and as the audience, that's you and me right now, we know that he's kind of looking back at these memories, especially that line, when I look at the picture, I can hear it, right? It's as if these memories are kind of popping up for him. And then at the end, we see this kind of sadness, which we'll get into. Like, I see something coming that ain't good. So he's got present day Lonnie, who is looking back at these photos and he knows all these things have happened in his life. So he's kind of adding that piece at the end, okay? Then we have diction, syntax, tone, and form. Those are some fancy poetry terms, right? Diction is just the way that language is used, okay? And diction could be your word choice, right? Whatever language that the speaker is using in the poem is the diction, okay? Some poets who are bilingual like to use both, for example, Spanish and English in their poems, and that helps enrich their poems in the meaning. Syntax is the arrangement of language, punctuation, and grammar. So syntax is the way that you're setting up your sentences in your poem, right? Are they short? Are they long? Are they complex? Are they simple sentences, right? Are they two independent clauses, right? Joined together, that makes a complex sentence, right? Or a compound, rather. And then a tone. So the tone is sort of the emotion that you're getting out of the poem that the speaker is relaying to the reader, right? And a tone can change over the course of a poem, but the tone of the poem is really, you're looking at who the speaker is talking about, what they're talking about, and how they're talking about it, right? The tone doesn't necessarily mean the mood, which we'll get to later. The form of the poem is actually, how is the poem laid out on the page, right? Does it have a lot of spaces between the stanzas? Does it have a lot of different single lines, right? And we'll look at form here. Okay, so the diction right now, we know that Lonnie is speaking. We know that he's not speaking very formally. This is not like an essay for his school, right? We know that he's kind of having a conversation with himself almost as he's looking through these photos. And we know that the language he's using is colloquial. Colloquial means that he's using language that is used in his region in the country. So there are certain words that people from New England say that people from the South don't necessarily say, or people who live in the Midwest don't necessarily say, right? Some people say bubbler, some people say water fountain, right? There are different words depending on where you are in the country. And where he's at in New York, a lot of people say the word ain't, right? So that colloquial, that regional term, that informal language is something that he's using, okay? For syntax, his sentences are simple and complex, right? We have a sentence at the end here, I'm looking away from it, frowning, like I see something coming that ain't good. He's using that word like to put two different pieces of sentences together, right? To make it more complex. But then there are simple sentences like there's two of me and Lily, we were little then, right? And so that rhythm is made by the way that he's structuring his sentences. Okay. The tone is very serious, right? Also reflective, sad, nostalgic. So when you are looking at tone in a poem, try to think about the emotions that are coming out of the speaker as they are talking to us really on the page about these different elements. Nostalgia is when you're looking back on a memory and you kind of, you're wishfully thinking that that memory could happen again, or you're looking back on it with, it could be sadness. It could be, you know, a childhood memory that you're like, oh, I wish I could, you know, build sandcastles again, right? Nostalgia is a very complex emotion. And sometimes it makes people feel sad and sometimes it makes people feel joyous, right? Or even angry, other emotions. But usually nostalgia is linked to wanting to go back to a certain place in time, right? So Lonnie's looking back at these pictures and his family, and there's that, you know, aching in him that we're feeling in this poem. So form, there isn't a specific form of this poem, right? There's no rhyme scheme, which we'll go over in another slide. This poem has stanzas and it has singular lines, but it's not rhyming at the end. So there's not a specific form or structure that it fits. So we would say that it's free verse, okay? And he does use a lot of free verse in the book. Our last ones that we're going over are style, stanza, line, and rhyme scheme. So style really is an author's way of writing. So it's a style really takes all of the elements like your tone, your emotion, your sentence structure, even the words that you choose are the writer's style. So style is kind of an element of poetry that doesn't have one specific meaning. It's really a bunch of different elements of poetry together to create a style. I also like to relate style to if you're listening to music, right? A lot of kids listen to music and adults. And when you're listening to music, like what kinds of elements of music are you listening to? How is jazz different from a pop song, right? And how is a rock song different from a rap? So there are different stylistic choices that happen in music that make different kinds of music different from each other. In the same way, there are different stylistic choices that a poet or a writer will make to fit a certain poem or to fit a certain form of writing, right? Like an essay doesn't look like a poem. There are different styles that you would use, right? And then stanza, I've gotten some questions about stanzas in a poem. When you are thinking about writing before you learn poetry in school, right? Like you're learning this year, you learn about paragraphs. Usually that's where writers start in schools. They start building paragraphs and sentences, right? And so I want you to think of a stanza in a poem as you would think of a paragraph in a story or in an essay. Okay. A stanza is a way of breaking up the poem by white space. And it's really the same thing as a paragraph. The line in a poem is usually a single sentence, and it's usually breaking away from the stanzas. Okay. A line in a poem is separate from the rest of the poem typically, and usually changes the tone or the mood depending on where that line is placed, right? So it definitely matters where you are placing your lines and how you're laying out your poem on your page. Lastly, the rhyme scheme. You do know of some verses and rhymes, maybe from nursery rhymes growing up. Rhyme scheme definitely has a place in poetry. Sometimes people use rhymes at the end of lines, but rhyme scheme is something that we talk about in more complex detail because it's not always a type of rhyme at the end of a line, right? But you might notice that every other line might rhyme, like the words in them. So we have, again, we have this poem, photographs. The style we've gone over is word choice, structure, form, and voice, right? So that's considering all of the different choices that a writer is making or a poet is making in this case. The stanza, right? It looks like we have two stanzas here. Really, they're groups of lines together. We're kind of thinking of stanzas as paragraphs, but relating to poetry, right? We have this first stanza. There's two of me and Lily all the way up to Easter Queen. Those four lines grouped together are a stanza. And then we have, here's mama and daddy dancing, all the way to look how she's laughing. That is another stanza, okay? And then we have lines. So you see these singular lines. Here's the four of us. When I look at a picture, I can hear it. That ain't good, right? Those are standing on its own. And so we see in the beginning of this, you know, he's looking at these memories. And then as we get, you know, to these different deeper thoughts, we have single lines. And then for rhyme scheme in this poem, there's no rhyme scheme. Okay. I hope that some of these elements of poetry in the review has helped you a little bit understand when you're going through your poetry packets. I have given you some elements of poetry. Really for our summer reading, you only need the first set of elements of poetry like I've given you here. And if you have further questions, please reach out. I'm on my email this summer. And I hope that you enjoyed learning some of these with me. Thank you.